When you have a read-based pass traversal, it's easy game. You just read a file, usually /etc/passwd, and you get a quick payout. But what about file write? You have to somehow prove the vulnerability exists. Usually you don't know where are you at, and you have to watch out to not overwrite a sensitive file because you may disrupt the service. To answer this question, I studied all the past traversal reports that I found in the internet, and I saw which one of them were write-based past traversals, and if yes, what file did the hunters write. In this video, I will show you those results along with some methods to escalate past traversal to an RCE. Enjoy! If it's your first time here, I do these case studies regularly. I take a back class, I extract all the reports that I can find in the internet, and then I study those reports. I already did SSRFs, XSSs, IDORs, and SQL injections, and past traversals are the fifth vulnerability class. They are mostly available in BBR Premium, but they always share some part to the public for free, such as in this case, I share the part where I will show you which file did the hunters write to prove the impact. So in most cases, actually hunters didn't really write any specific files. In these cases, the hunters would just write a file that's outside the directory. So they would prove that they can write a file where they shouldn't, outside the safe directory, but they wouldn't really care about what's the file content or file name. Like in this case, we have a write-based pass traversal in Kroki vulnerability in GitLab. And we can see here that the hunter would just write a temporary file, a test file write.txt, because if you write a file outside the safe directory, obviously it's not the directory where the file should have been saved. This is enough to prove to the program, especially to a mature program like GitLab, that you can really write a file anywhere, and often you can turn it into an RCE. In some programs you also have to prove this. In this case, in case of GitLab, I think they just believe that if you can have a file write, you can easily just turn it into an RCE. And this is the trend here, that these reports with writing any file but writing it outside safe directory is present in applications where hunters have access to the source code. It's open source and hunters just install this on their own machine, where they can monitor what files are being created, and it just makes it easier to detect a past traversal like this, because if it's a black box test, you may just struggle to do anything. Also, in this case study, I noticed much more than usual 0 days, like bugs in Ruby on Rails, bugs in Apache, bugs in Node.js. There were many, many more of them compared to other case studies that I've done, while the overall amount of reports, the number of reports was smaller. It was only 74 reports of path traversals that I found online, which is way less than, for example, XSSs. And some bugs were like this. We can see it's a bug in the library in Ruby, and the hunter just creates their own vulnerable source code. It's not even a direct attack on a web application right in Ruby, or created in Ruby, but it's just a library bug. And in this case, also, it's just creating a temporary file in arbitrary directory, and the hunter didn't have to prove anything more. Here we also have a very interesting bug, a bug that I was not aware of because I'm not a mobile hacker, but the report is partially disclosed, but it's really describing what happened there. So we have a typical zip slip attack, where the attacker can create a malicious zip with a file that's outside the safe directory after unpacking the archive. 2 weeks ago, I created a video about my code QL query to detect these kinds of bugs. So watch the video if you haven't already. But what happens here is this is not an attack on the server. This is an attack on the mobile app. And the way it works is, for some reason, I'm not sure what reason, the file is extracted on the mobile phone of the victim. And there, within the file system of the mobile, the file is extracted outside the safe directory. In this case, the hunter has shown that just overwriting app's private folders. I'm not sure what's the real impact of this, but there was another very similar report in Slack where the hunter was able to somehow, it was not disclosed exactly how, was able to leak access tokens of the victim using this very attack. Going forward, in 3 cases, the hunters were able to upload just a shell to the server, which is, I think, the most straightforward way to exploit a write-based path traversal. It will not work in modern programming languages like Python, like Node.js. It will work in PHP-based technologies. Here we have a bug in Apache, so this is more general. So I believe the hunter simply used PHP as an example, because why not? Because they could. And in this case, you can just upload your shell anywhere. This report is very interesting, because take a look at this bypass. I'm not sure if you recognize this, but the encoded %32 means digit 2, and %65 means letter F, small f. So if you decode these and join it with these percent sign, you get %2f, which is regular encoded forward slash. But what we see here is we have an unencoded percent in the beginning, and then we have the 2f encoded. So this is not a typical double URL encoding payload, because what should happen here is, I believe, according to the specs, this should be invalid input. This should be denied, because the percent sign is not followed by a hex number. And this is probably what happened, is the first component would see this, would ignore this case that I just told you about, would decode these two characters to 2F, and then the next component, maybe just a function or whatever happens there, I didn't study it in detail, takes the %2F, which is a regular encoded forward slash, and decodes it, leading to this path traversal. And this is a very good example of why sometimes we should look for inconsistencies. And when you have an inconsistency, it is enough to have a bug, because there is nothing inherently bad about accepting this invalid input if your component is on its own. But in this case, with many transformations happening to the URL, it led to a bug. It led to a critical path traversal in Apache, which is something. But we also have more payloads that probably they don't look like valid URL encoded strings. So it was an interesting one. We also had one bug in WordPress, where the hunter also, I think, only mentioned that it can lead to an RCE. He didn't actually exploit it, I believe. And this is something you can exploit in WordPress or in PHP-based app. But if you're working with Python, with Ruby, this will not work, because Python or Ruby do not process files the same way PHP does. In PHP, you can just upload the file to a particular directory, and then you can just send a request And if the file is in the directory, it will be returned. Most modern languages don't work this way, and you can't do this so as simply as you can in PHP, but you can still get something similar. Here we have an example of another 0 day in Ruby on Rails, and in this case the hunter was able to, it was obviously also file write based vulnerability, and to exploit this vulnerability the hunter would overwrite a template. So the way Ruby on Rails application works is you have some templates that are usually ERB templates, which means it's saved in a file called text ERB in this case. I believe it's often html.erb, and it looks like a normal HTML, but inside you can have variables like this. So you can have a dynamic HTML. And contrary to normal shell uploads, which won't work in Ruby, this can work in Ruby. So when the hunter would overwrite this file, it may look like a very random name, but if you are familiar with Ruby, you probably can predict that this path would exist, and the hunter would just overwrite with this bug this file with an arbitrary command, because the template allows the user to execute arbitrary Ruby code, which also in this case means executing system level commands, so it is a proper RCE. And then when you upload something like this, it means that the controller of books, which is supposed to show you a book, will try to open this file and fill it with some information about the book. So to trigger the RCE, you have to send another request which will speak to the books controller in this case, and it will just fetch any book, and in this case it will try to execute this template, which also executes this code. And the hunter proved it by just using the ls command, and the file is here. We had touch me, which means it creates an empty file called me, and it was created. Another case where the hunter just had access to the source code and had everything under control. With black box test, it is perfectly possible to predict this path, but it's definitely harder than doing it white box. So watch out for this. And also, if you have a file write based path traversal or another bug when you can write files and you're not working with PHP, try to see if the application works with template files, because overwriting a template file may be the easiest way to turn your bug into an RCE. And finally, there was also one bug where the RCE exploit was done by overwriting the SSH authorized keys. So the way it works is you have a file in Linux that's .ssh/authorized keys, which contains public encryption keys. And when you log into the server, you can use your username and password if that's enabled. But if you are authenticating yourself with your private key and your public key is in the authorized keys file, it means you can log in automatically to the server. And this is what the hunter did here. He overwrote the SSH/authorized keys file with the content of his public SSH key, which meant that when now authenticating to the target machine, he could authenticate with his private key, which is easy. The problem with this works magnificently if you have access to the attacked machine, the network access over port 2020, which should be rare. And also the machine has to be configured to not prevent this attack. Then it works like a charm. In this case, we have GitLab, so the hunter could set it up as he wanted. In case of a black box test, it shouldn't work. It may work, so you should always try this, but it should not work because the machine should not expose port 2020 to the internet without a VPN or whatever. But in case you need this, in case you are in the internal assessment, definitely you can exploit FileWrite by overwriting authorized keys with your public key, and then you just SSH into the machine and you have a shell. And these are all the different files that were wrote, which I saw during this case study. I hope that you did learn some new tricks in this video. If you did, leave a like. And if you enjoyed this small part of the case study, if you join VBR Premium, you will get access to the whole case study as well as the previous case studies about SSRFs, XSSs, IDORs, and SQL injections. And if you want to watch another video with the free part of the case study, I suggest you this one, where I broke down what payloads for XSSs were Hunter using to get the biggest payouts. For now, thank you for watching and goodbye.